Welcome to this week's Pascal's China Lens, and we're going to talk about electrical vehicles and what's happening in China and how China is wanting to take on the world when it comes to building the new EVs in the world. And I believe that there's a real good chance that the biggest manufacturer and the best brands in the world in the car of the future could come from China. Now, I want to thank everybody for subscribing to my channel. I bought myself a new vlogging camera and some new lights to elevate the quality of my videos. I hope you will like it. If you haven't subscribed so yet on my channel, do so now so you can follow a lot of my movies about China, about innovation in China, about the disruption, about social in China, what is really happening in that country that we don't always know a lot about. So more than 100 years ago, Henry Ford started Ford Motors. And the whole automotive industry just started a revolution, which today is still extremely interesting to look at. Now, later on, it went from Detroit to Europe, in Germany, in France, in Italy, in the UK, in Sweden, lots of places where the biggest brands and the most famous companies were building the cars of the future. Then later, end of last century, it was all about Japan and Honda and Toyota and so on. And the question is, could now, this century, it all be about China? Could China lead the new car industry, and specifically an electrical vehicle? I believe there's a really good chance, and I'm going to talk a little bit about this. Now, just about a month ago, at the Shanghai Auto Show, there was 800,000 visitors, imagine, in COVID-19 period still. And all of these visitors, they visited more than 1,000 different car manufacturers. And they all want to buy these new cars, and a lot of them is electrical vehicle. Now in China, 1 out of 10 people own a personal car. Now in Europe, that's 1 out of 2. In America, it's 1 out of 1. It means every American has a car on average. What that means is that if Chinese would all buy a car like Americans would, each have one car, then we would have serious traffic jams. The biggest traffic jam ever recorded in history was in China. There's one guy that claims he got stuck for 7 days. I don't know if it's true, but it shows that adding 10 times more cars in a country like China would be a disaster, specifically when we think about the ecology, the environment. I mean, there's already so much pollution, and more than 1 million people get killed because of the pollution in China every year. So imagine this going times 10. It's not bearable. This is not something China can continue. But is it really all about the environment when we think about electrical vehicles? There's actually one other aspect, and that's oil. Because a lot of oil gets imported into China these days. And if you look at the history, China was self-sufficient many, many years back, but today it's really depending on the oil of the world. And so this is one of the real motivations for China, the country in itself, to go full electrical, because then they're not dependent on the oil from the US and the Middle East and all these countries that might block it at some point. So this is the real reason. And so for the past decades, China has been investing billions of dollars into building batteries. It started from the mobile phone industry. Before that was all Japan, and then it moved into China. And big companies like BYD, they started building the best batteries in the world. And now today, most of the battery industry is actually run by China. They've had so much capacity these days. We're talking about more than 60% of capacity, both on the components, on the cells, the raw materials. It's almost 80% globally that is produced in China. And there's only 4 countries like America, Poland, South Korea, and China that are really producing the batteries for the world, specifically for the cars. So they almost got a monopoly. And it's just not about the fact that they're building batteries. They're building the smartest batteries, and a lot of innovation is coming from China. Even Tesla is using the CATL batteries in its products. So this is really something that China has invested in. The other thing they've invested in over the past years is charging stations. I went to China in 2019 to visit State Grid, one of the biggest energy companies in the world. It's probably the biggest. And they showed me this picture that I took, which is about all the charging stations over the whole country. In just 2 years' time, they installed more than 1 million charging stations. And when there's all these stations, that means electrical vehicles can charge everywhere. This is a big advantage of the infrastructure investment that China has done and that the US didn't do. Now, Biden might change that, but so far, a lot of the EV is not taking off in the US because people can't charge everywhere. So the question we should really ask ourselves is, can China actually build a great car? And so to do that, we have to go back in history and look at 1958. That's a long, long time ago. At that moment, there was the factory FAW that was producing a great Chinese car called Hongqi. And Hongqi means red flag in Chinese. Now, this has nothing to do with a red flag. This has to do with everything, of course, that this car was meant for high-ranking officials, the Communist Party, the government officials. And so this was almost the Rolls-Royce of the Chinese cars, and they were really able to build this top-end car. But in the 80s, they stopped the production because there wasn't a lot of demand anymore. And in the 90s, they started again in mid-90s. But by then, actually, the brand has lost a lot of its flavor. Now, this was a real great brand. But up to the 90s, and I think that's the most important story, China was not able to build a great car for the general population. But besides that, there wasn't really an automotive industry. You had to wait until the 90s. That's not so long ago, 30 years ago, before China started producing its own cars. So without a joint venture, but building their own cars. There were lots of joint ventures in the 80s and the 90s, but to build their own car, it was really a low-end car, and primarily for the government, because they were the only ones that could afford it early in the 90s. Later on, in the early this century, it was all about copying designs. So not copying the product anymore, but creating better and better quality for these with these products. But the design looked just like Geely had almost a Mercedes design, and then the Landwind, I don't need to explain you what car that resembles. These were all mid-end cars, so they were moving up. And so all these mid-end cars were mostly aimed at private owners. And that was the big change at the beginning of this century. So this is only 20 years ago. Now, the last 5 years have been very interesting, because that's where the whole car industry in China has moved up to the high end. They're still doing low end and middle end, but they've moved up. They have the quality, they have great designs now, and now they're thinking more global design and global quality. And specifically, the electrical vehicle is changing everything, because now they're aiming at disrupting this market. And that's where we see a lot of new players like Byton, like NIO, like XPeng, AIways, a lot of these companies we haven't heard about 5 years ago. And now today, if we look at the future, it's all going to be about service. This is about players that weren't in the car industry before. Players like Baidu, players like Didi, the mobility company, a lot of cell phone players, and suddenly they're all going, these tech players, into the new future of the car. And they want to build that car of the future. And this is all about autonomous and self-driving and connectivity, and it's a service model rather than an ownership model. So China has moved very fast in 20 years' time. Now, what we see is that since 2018, the valuations of some of these brands we never heard about, like Li Auto, NIO, and XPeng, have just exploded, going up to $100 billion in valuations. I mean, only Tesla can keep up with that pace. And they're almost as valuable as companies like Ford if we wait a few years. So this is quite interesting. And so it seems to be a race for money. Those that can raise more money can actually lead this industry. Because besides the cars, you also need to have all these charging stations, and you need to invest in services and connectivity and autonomous and a lot of things like sharing industry. And so there's a lot of money needed. And the Chinese have a lot of money. And this puts them at the forefront. Now, if we look at the car industry itself, the EV industry, what we see is that it's only today like 4% of all new electrical vehicles are actually, all new vehicles are actually electrical vehicles. So still a very, very small percentage. But China is taking up the biggest part of that market. That's why all the foreign manufacturers are all launching their cars at auto shows like in Shanghai. They want that Chinese market. It's 50% of the market almost. Now Europe is catching up, and you see that many, many countries are now starting to become together as big as China. US is still far behind. They're smaller than Germany, but they will catch up eventually as well. And the Chinese part share will be smaller, but in terms of numbers, it's gigantic. Now, if you look at that, what you see is that is the reason why everybody in China wants to build an EV. There's a huge market potential. There's still 96% of opportunity. Now, the reason that the Chinese government and China has been so successful at in just 5 years' time to build a whole EV industry has a lot to do with the subsidies. The government has subsidized primarily the manufacturers to start with, so they would all create a supply, they would build these cars, and there's many, many cars available. And then later on, when all these cars were available, they targeted and subsidized the consumers, which means that consumers could buy an electrical vehicle cheaper than buying a combustion engine. And that created that whole demand that people were actually buying the cars. So there's the cars that were supplied, there's the cars that get bought, and it starts creating a mindset change. And now that this has happened and that almost 10% of all new cars that are bought are electrical vehicles, what you see is that they want to target society. That means they want to subsidize cars that don't cost too much, like $30,000-$35,000, so not the Teslas of this world. And they also want cars to have long range, driving range, like 300, 400 kilometers. Everything else doesn't get subsidized. So the small little $4,500 car is not getting subsidized. But it really created this demand, this supply, and now it's healthy, high quality cars. Ultimately, the subsidy will end very soon. But the thing is that by then, everything has changed. And this is a ball that gets rolling and the momentum keeps going. China has 500 registered electrical vehicle car manufacturers in the country. 500. That's incredible. I mean, everybody's starting to build EVs. And of course, there's going to be consolidation one day. But right now, it's like crazy. And that means that everybody wants to do something different. And that is fueling innovation. So stay tuned on this channel next week, because I'm going to talk about the different brands next week of electrical vehicles. So this will be the second part of this video, which is really going to talk about how China is differentiating itself with Western competitors in the EV world. If you haven't subscribed yet, do so now so you can follow next week, and hope to see you next week for another episode on Pascal's China Lens.